Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Healing Your Inner Child, Reparenting Yourself for a More Secure and Loving Life by Natasha Levinger. Narrated by Elisabeth Ashby. Introduction. I am writing this book for anyone who needs it, and I'm also writing it for my 21-year-old self. And my 6-year-old self, and my 15-year-old self. I'm writing this book for all of our inner children who felt like whatever sad, angry, scared, or upsetting feeling they were experiencing in that moment was the absolute complete truth, and that they were alone in it. As you will learn in this book, our wounded inner child is stuck in the past, where they are lost in their worldview. The inner child's perspective is usually very self-limiting, made up of extreme either-or beliefs, you're the best or you're the worst, and unaware of the adult self that exists in the present. When we merge with the inner child, we get lost in this viewpoint, losing sight of who we really are. We go down a portal like the one in Alice in Wonderland, a drop into another world that makes us forget our wholeness and has us thinking we are broken or not enough. I have been a practicing intuitive reader, medium, energy healer, and inner child healing teacher for a while now, and I have never met anyone who is actually broken. Our true selves are whole, complete, and a great source of love. Maybe they are even love itself. Most of our problems, in my opinion, stem from splitting off from that innately worthy self and forgetting who we really are. I relate to many of my clients who grew up in homes where their true selves were conditioned out of them. My mother had a dominant, narcissistic personality, and I learned very quickly that my inner compass had to be focused on her, or I would suffer the consequences. The consequences in my case looked like anything from emotional abandonment to triangulation to verbal abuse. This left me cut off from my intuition and with an innate feeling that there was something wrong with me. Children need to establish a feeling of safety within. When our parents are hurting us, we often believe that we are the bad ones in order to retain a feeling of control. But if we imagine that our caregivers are bad, how are we supposed to feel truly secure? It's impossible. We simply cannot hold that knowledge in our hearts and minds. We don't have an inner adult yet. We only have the external adult in front of us. So, we then must become the ones at fault. And as you'll learn in a later chapter, we literally don't have the ability to calm our own nervous systems when we are that young. When this kind of conflict happens, we split from our true authentic self and develop parts of ourselves that can help us survive in the environment. That looks different for everyone. It can look like developing a part of your personality that is determined to be perfect at all costs, or cutting yourself off from your feelings, or being a bully like your caretaker, or attacking yourself with judgment in order to do it before your parent does, to name a few responses. We then grow up, and until we learn how to honor and validate our true selves and each create a real inner adult, we will feel our inner children as being real and alive, as if we were still kids. Learning inner child healing can help you develop that inner adult while also integrating and welcoming your past self with an open heart. By practicing the energy healing techniques outlined in this book, you can get to know your true, expansive nature more and more deeply. You do not have to have had a traumatic background in order to benefit from inner child healing. We can't compare trauma, and no one has come through childhood without pain. We can also have wounding as adults. And you may have had an incredibly supportive home life, but dealt with systemic racism or homophobia, or maybe you grew up in poverty, or you suffered from any number of issues that were out of your control. All of that is certainly out of our depth to handle when we are children. But when we can learn to experience ourselves as having a center of a loving adult that is validating of our inner child, we can feel more supported, resilient, and capable of handling whatever comes up. My journey started in 1992 when I discovered inner child healing through my therapist at that time, Margaret Paul. Later, I learned energy healing from a teacher who was trained at Psychic Horizons in San Francisco. And more recently, I became familiar with internal family systems, which is an amazing modality of therapy that uses inner child work. The tools I learned that I am sharing with you in this book have given me the ability to care for the versions of myself that still believed the childhood programming, stating that they weren't enough and no one cared for them. These tools helped me to find out and connect to who I really am. It's an honor to be able to share them with you. Author's note: I have shared some of my clients' experiences in this book. Their names have been changed to protect their privacy. Chapter 1. What is the inner child, and why should we get to know them? The phrase inner child is commonly used these days, but it can turn a lot of people off because it may seem too cutesy or vague. You might visualize a version of yourself as a child sitting inside of you, but that's a little weird. And also, how is that helpful? Spoiler alert, it's incredibly helpful. I guess that's not really a spoiler if I've written a whole book about it. Of all the tools I've shared with my clients and all of the tools I've learned myself, it has been one of the most helpful, if not the most helpful. The concept of labeling this part of our psyche as the inner child is relatively new. It was originally conceived by Eric Byrne, a Canadian psychoanalyst, who called it the child ego state in 1940. This means that our ego, our sense of identity, has many different parts, and the inner child is part of it. So is the inner critic, and even the inner parent. Although its meaning might seem clear enough at this abstract level, that doesn't give us a sense of what it means to really feel it on an intuitive level in a way that allows us to understand what that means for us personally. So, setting theory aside, the best way I've found to explain it is this. The inner child represents your gut feelings, from the most painful and challenging to the happiest and most creative and joyful ones. The painful ones are coming from the past, where your wounded inner child lives, still feeling they are in those past moments. But the happy ones are expressions of who you are in the present, your true self beyond trauma or painful childhood programming. In the somatic experiencing framework, they say that trauma is not the terrible thing that happened to you, but the energy that gets locked in your body as a result of it. So, to use that language, that energy is the inner child. Let's say you were emotionally abandoned frequently in childhood. You weren't able to have the trauma-negative feelings resolved because your caretakers weren't capable of doing that. No one came to you and said, "Oh, I'm so sorry that I rejected you. I shouldn't have taken my problems out on you. I love you. I'm here now. It wasn't your fault." Now, when you experience anything close to abandonment, which could even look like someone withdrawing for reasons having nothing to do with you, that energy of the inner child gets activated, and it feels like childhood abandonment. You can have multiple wounded inner child parts that are waiting to be rescued by your inner parent, who can let them know, "Hey, I'm here. It's the present, and you don't need to stay in that moment any longer. I'm an adult. I'm your caretaker. You are safe." The gut punch feeling one of my clients felt when she told her brother she was going back to school and he said it sounded like another one of your pipe dreams came from a wounded inner child part. Even though she also was feeling his criticism in the moment, the intensity of it came from the past, when she always had to perform perfectly in order to get her mother's approval. Later, we'll get more into what to do when you are having an appropriate reaction to something happening while simultaneously experiencing an inner child reaction to it, also known as life. But that feeling of glee I feel jumping on a trampoline? That's my free, happy inner child. And that is coming from the present joyful moment. You may have noticed that I used extreme ends of the emotional spectrum to describe what the inner child is feeling, and that is because the feelings associated with your inner child generally are extreme. Real-life children often think in extremes. This is the best day of my life, or I hate everyone. And when we become aware of our inner child, we will notice that kind of language when we talk to ourselves as being an indication that the inner child is in the proverbial house. The inner critic, who is often an inner child part, also uses extreme language like this, and in both cases, it's a good way for you to know that the inner parent is definitely not at home. Throughout this book, when I refer to the inner child, I'm usually referring to the wounded inner child, the one who needs healing. Think of a time you felt rejected, sad, ashamed, any challenging feeling in your adult life. The wounded inner child is the reactionary part of you that is rooted in those unresolved feelings. When we perceive interactions in our lives through the lens of an original historical wound, that is the perception of the wounded inner child. So, if you think back to 8th grade, when people got Valentines from their friends but you didn't, and you feel that tug of ugh in your stomach, that's your inner child tugging at you, wanting you to reassure them that you are lovable and worthy. You may experience it as a heaviness or sadness, or maybe a voice saying, "No one loved you, even then." Rude. That would be the inner critic, but we'll get into their whole deal soon. Let's use the same example and apply it to the present. Let's say you're out with your friends and it seems like everyone is talking to each other, but not to you. You feel down and may even think, "Why am I always the last one anyone wants to talk to? No one wants to be friends with me." That would be the wounded inner child part that didn't get those Valentines and has coupled not getting those cards in the past with the idea of people not wanting to be its friend ever. It may even go further back to rejections from parents that made that time in 8th grade sting even more. So even though on the surface you may judge yourself for overreacting or being too sensitive, the truth is that the inner child always has a good reason for feeling hurt. If you are a human on Earth, you have the inner child tugging at you to varying degrees. There is nothing wrong with it. In fact, it's a rich, sensitive, vital part of yourself. You don't even have to have come from trauma to experience the wounded inner child. We all have experienced something that wasn't quite resolved, from something as serious as being othered by systemic racism and homophobia to feeling left out at a sleepover. Comparing pain isn't helpful. It keeps us from healing it. All of our pain deserves our attention. When an event is not resolved, it can't just disappear. We can't see it with our eyes, but it doesn't dissipate into the ether, never to be heard from again. Many times we brush past these feelings or shove them down because they feel like too much or annoying. We are still feeling them, but we are resisting them, hoping that if we just ignore them long enough, they will go away. But as Carl Jung said, what we resist persists. And in my experience with feelings, what we resist gets stronger and often comes out sideways. We've all likely experienced crying over a commercial and thinking, "I have no idea why I'm crying right now." Or we lashed out at someone and immediately knew that we weren't even mad at that person, but didn't know why the anger was just there, ready to explode. When dealing with feelings, we must meet them head-on for them to truly dissipate. This can be especially annoying to hear for those of us who would much prefer that feelings stay out of things, unless they are happy feelings. I have heard many a client say something along the lines of, "Why can't they just go away? I don't need them." But stay they do, until we shine a light on them and hopefully understand them and give them self-compassion. When we do that, we will feel integrated and understood. By directly working with that part of ourselves, the inner child, we are able to come to a resolution not just with that issue in the moment, but also with past hurts. you may be surprised to find that you feel resolution after working with yourself on an issue that has been bothering you when you thought you'd always need an apology from someone else or other closure from an external source. The more we communicate with our inner child, the more we feel heard and seen, and the more we start to feel safe within ourselves and less plagued by the past. We heal. We integrate the part of ourselves that has felt pushed aside and dismissed with the rest of us. We give ourselves permission to experience all of ourselves, not just cherry-picked acceptance of various traits we've deemed good enough. As an intuitive reader and healer, I work with people by looking within their energy fields to see what is underneath the issues they are coming to me with. They are mad at their partner because they brushed them off, but what is the root of that pain? Is it feeling ignored, dismissed, not seen? In almost every session with people, I see their inner child, because 9 times out of 10, this is where that root pain originated. That time you got upset with your partner for forgetting to pick up apples on the way home, even though you knew on paper there was nothing to be upset about? That's coming from your inner child. Maybe when you were younger, your parents always forgot to pick you up from school, or said they would get you things you wanted but rarely followed through. You grew up and forgot about it, but your inner child didn't. Or maybe the problem that seemed like nothing really was something to be upset about. It's not that your partner forgot the apples, but that it's symptomatic of an imbalance in the relationship. But your reaction made it impossible for you to stay centered about that issue in the moment because the feelings were overwhelming. On those occasions, it is highly likely that the part of yourself that is reacting is rooted in older feelings of hurt or anger. It's rooted in your dad promising he would come to your game and finding excuses at the last minute as to why he couldn't. So yes, sometimes, when you feel strongly about something that has happened, you have every right to be upset. But you then have to sort through the delicate balance of what is yours and what is theirs. Let me reiterate, even if your reaction is rooted in trauma, you still have a right to be upset. All feelings are valid. What's not okay is when we blame other people for those feelings, especially when the pain is coming from an old wound, the inner child, and we attribute the full weight of what we are experiencing to the present argument. Does it mean you are overreacting? Not at all. If there really is an imbalance in the relationship that needs to be addressed, that is real. But it is also possible that simultaneously it's activating your wounded inner child, and part of you needs to know you hear them. Once they feel better after being seen by you, you can better know how to address the situation without being merged with your inner child. Cindy was a client of mine who grew up without a father after he left her family when she was only 5 years old. He did not give an explanation and rarely spoke to her after that day. Naturally, she was very hurt from this experience. She didn't have the tools yet to soothe and validate the inner child that still felt his absence acutely. She had a flourishing and fulfilling career, but found herself drawn to relationships where she had to prove herself in order to get love. She was seeing a man who was intermittent with his communication and had a tendency to give and then withdraw love. So this was a case where both her inner child was activated and her relationship was not giving her the reliability she needed to feel safe. The man was not reliable in a relationship, and it was also hitting her old wound of abandonment. Through dialoguing with her inner child, which we will learn about soon, Cindy was able to see how she was abandoning herself. She saw how, when he would pull away, she would pull away from herself as well, trying desperately to figure him out instead of figuring out what she needed. She began to build a relationship with her inner loving adult, where she showed up for herself more and developed trust within. Through this trust, Cindy also learned by dialoguing with her inner child that she didn't feel safe with her boyfriend. When her boyfriend didn't return her texts, it brought up all the feelings of being abandoned again from childhood, which were disproportionate to the present situation. But her boyfriend was also not reliable and not someone who could be in the type of relationship she wanted. The question then changes from, "Am I overreacting?" to, "What unmet need requires my attention right now?" When you understand this dynamic, you can begin to address the core issue and get clear about what is actually happening in the moment. It can also happen that you are responding to a past pain alone, and the person in front of you is not doing anything to trigger it. My client Marcia was raised with narcissistic parents who were overly concerned with how well she did in school and obsessed with her being thin. Her way of creating safety as a child was to be achievement-oriented. She knew if she performed well in school and was thin enough for her parents' standards, they would give her love. She also knew that if she didn't do well, they would withdraw their love. They would criticize her and become cold toward her. This can feel like death to a child. Parental rejection in childhood feels life-threatening because we have no way to survive without our parents. It creates desperation in the child to get their love, and they live in survival mode until they get it. During one of our sessions, Marcia told me about a situation where a friend of hers, whom she idealized, had asked about a shirt she was wearing. Marcia took offense, assuming the friend was pointing out her shirt because it wasn't as expensive as the clothes that this friend wore. However, it was clear, even though I was only hearing Marcia's side of the story, that the friend meant nothing by it and genuinely liked the shirt. Marcia got very angry with her friend and, after a terse interaction, blocked her from her phone and social media accounts. Through our session, we were able to identify that Marcia's inner child felt so threatened by her friend's perceived success that it brought up all of her feelings of inadequacy from childhood. This inadequacy felt like a life and death threat, just like it did in childhood. Marcia was not reacting to what was happening in the moment, but rather to the threat of early childhood survival. After our session, Marcia was able to see the truth of the source of her pain, but unfortunately, not everything gets tied up in a neat bow. Her friend set a boundary, and they were not able to repair the friendship. Still, Marcia was able to notice her reactions in the future and become mindful of the fact that she was often reacting from her wound, which is the first step. When she learned the techniques of dialoguing with her inner child and learning how to soothe that part of herself, she was able to catch herself before she lashed out in the future. As time went on, and her inner child felt like Marcia didn't need her to be on a certain level in order to be loved, this kind of thing was rarely a trigger. If it did come up, she was able to address it right away and make herself feel heard and seen. You may notice I didn't say that it was never a trigger ever again. This is pretty big programming she had to override. I do believe that over time it will be possible for her to completely feel safe and not feel triggered, but growth is not a straight line, and it's unrealistic to think that all this might go away after only a few conversations with her inner child. The relationship with your secure inner adult takes time to build trust, just like any other, and she will feel trusting of herself if she commits to it. When you begin to build this relationship, remember that it will take time for you, too, but you may begin to see results in your interactions with friends and family right away. Are we ever overreacting? In the example I used earlier, Marcia was overreacting in the way most people use that term. She wasn't reacting in proportion to the situation she was dealing with in the present. She was instead reacting proportionally to the inner child's wound of the past. If I was her friend, I would definitely think of it as an overreaction. It simply was not in the reality of the present moment. And yet, I still caution against using the term overreacting when we are examining our behavior. It comes with judgment and even shame, and we cannot grow from that place. Of course, we need to be able to judge a situation, but that is different from judging our feelings as being too much or wrong. When instead we reframe our reaction by understanding it with curiosity rather than criticism, we can see where there is room for growth and change. When we do that, we can unmerge from our inner child and see the reality of the present moment. In Marcia's case, she could then see, okay, I really was not reacting to what was happening. My friend was just trying to give me a compliment. Then she could give herself compassion, apologize, and move on. Throughout this book, we will go into how to start in this place in order to do work with our inner child. Most important, we'll need to establish our loving inner parent first. In the class I teach on working with the inner child, the first module is all about developing the inner parent, because all of this work needs to be grounded from that place before we do anything else. The inner parent needs to be in the driver's seat. Imagine if you let a 6-year-old drive you around. Unless your driver is a very tall 6-year-old, they literally won't be able to see where they are going and can't reach the brakes. They'll probably stop a lot for ice cream when you have somewhere else you need to be. And they might look away from the road a lot to yell at their brother. In real life, when your inner 6-year-old is at the emotional wheel, it can feel equally jarring. It also explains the lack of impulse control, especially when your brother is annoying. If the inner adult is not in charge, you are merged with the inner child. When this happens, you don't have the neutrality that the inner parent is able to have, which is what you need to feel your most free, authentic self and make the best decisions for your life. Before we get further into understanding the different aspects of the inner child, I want to say a word about this idea of even having different voices or parts of ourselves that live within us. We appear to each other as being one unified person with one voice inside. And obviously, we do have one literal voice. But how many times have you heard, "I'm of two minds about this," or "I am split on how I feel about this"? How many people do you know who are behaving in ways you know they don't want to behave? We only need to look at times when we tell ourselves we are going to quit smoking, stop eating a certain way, or change any other habit, and then do the opposite. In those situations, it's easy to see that there is definitely more than one part of us operating in our psyche. Historically, the idea of having multiple parts living inside of us has been demonized and looked at as mental illness, which in and of itself has so much stigma attached to it, wrongfully so. And there is a mental illness called dissociative identity disorder, where people do in fact split more severely into disparate psychological parts. There is no shame in knowing when you have a mental illness and doing what you need to do to take care of yourself. So many people suffer from it needlessly because of the shame around admitting it. But recognizing that your psyche consists of different parts is not necessarily an indicator of mental illness. It just means that you are a human. Because it is so pathologized, sometimes people get scared about delving into the various parts of their personality, thinking that if they do, it's going to prove how unwell they are. The truth is that it is extremely healthy to explore more of who you are and become attuned to the many aspects of yourself. They exist whether you are aware of them or not, and acknowledging them brings them to the light, where you can heal them. The more we know ourselves, and the more we accept all of our thoughts and feelings, the more unified we can become so we can follow through with what we want to do and show up authentically. When we hold back emotions, they become stronger, until we look at them and accept them. You can't ignore a feeling into oblivion. The same is true for ignoring the parts of ourselves that are trying to be heard. No one goes about their day without feeling conflicting thoughts, but we're much happier when we have a strong, loving inner parent at the helm who accepts them. The Shadow and the Inner Child. The opposite of bringing your inner child to the light so you can see them and heal them is pushing them down into your shadow where you don't have to deal with them at all. The shadow, which was an idea first conceived of by Carl Jung, is the idea that we all have parts of ourselves that we reject, and therefore we send them to the shadows of our psyche. When we judge our thoughts and feelings, we send them away into the darkness of our subconscious, so we can then live happily ever after. JK, this doesn't work. What actually ends up happening is that these feelings come out sideways. You end up snapping at your partner for putting the dishes away wrong. Yes, there is a right way, Carol. Except that you don't really care about the dishes. You're mad at your boss, but you feel powerless because you can't tell her off. Or, in a bigger example, you don't want to face the pain of the relationship with your father, but you end up attracting that same kind of relationship over and over, which makes you miserable. As Carl Jung said, until you make the unconscious conscious, it will rule your life and you will call it fate. The wounded inner child is part of this shadow. If we are rejecting the inner child's needs, feeling that they are not important or that they are shameful, then you cannot heal them. You cannot heal what you can't see. There is a wealth of information in the feelings of your wounded inner child, and when examined, it can lead to you feeling happier, more satisfied, and complete. Inner child healing, then, is a form of shadow work. Think about your closest relationships. If you come home and find your partner quietly brooding about something without telling you why they're upset, or if they are lashing out at you without explaining their actions, that is the not fun combination of poor communication and hurt feelings. Until you address this dynamic, you might feel angry or anxious. The same thing happens with ourselves when we shut down communication with the parts of us that are feeling upset. Then we might end up feeling grumpy all day without understanding why, or checking out by binge-watching or mindless eating. The most important relationship we have is with ourselves. This relationship affects everything in our lives. It's the center point from which everything else flows. So why wouldn't we want to have fulfilling communication with all of the parts of ourselves, including the inner child? Just like in any relationship, if you open up communication with your inner child, you will have a much more enriching and satisfying connection. Remember, you have a fun, playful, creative part of you that is the inner child. They are not wounded, and they are still very much a part of you. That side of you comes out more and more the more you feel seen and heard. That is such an important part of why we are here, to do the things that bring us joy and add light to the world, and to bring those qualities to other people. So how can you even know if your inner child needs your attention? Maybe it's obvious to you, but in case it isn't, here are some ways to know that your wounded inner child is asking for attention.
You are in any... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.